Praise the Lord, everybody. Let's stand to our feet, and we want to welcome you to the house of the Lord. Amen. Aren't you excited that Jesus died and he rose again on the third day for you and me? Amen. Why don't you turn around and welcome somebody to the house of the Lord and just tell them Jesus is alive. And you know what? If you've been filled with the Holy Spirit, you can say, and he lives inside of me.
Hallelujah.
Yes. Amen. We're just going to celebrate today that the Lord is risen. Hallelujah. There's this new song that just says, risen, risen. He's forever glorified. We want you to just praise the Lord with us as we celebrate the risen Savior. Come on, let's give the Lord a shout of praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. He's an amazing God. The Bible says that it says, shout unto the Lord with the voice of triumph. Amen. And every time that we shout, that we lift our voice, you know, people might say we're crazy, and that's all right, because I think some people are crazier, because they go and they shout in stadiums at football games and basketball games and stuff, because they get all excited. But, you know, we have something to be so much more excited about, and that's about Jesus. Amen. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And so we celebrate him today. Hallelujah. We have a reason to shout. We have a reason to give him thanks. Hallelujah. Yeah, come on. Let's just say thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for loving us. Thank you, Jesus, for dying for us. And thank you, Jesus, for raising again on the third day. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. At this time, why don't you turn and tell somebody one good thing that God has done for you? Just one thing. If you could think of one thing. I thank the Lord because he's given me life, another day of life. I thank the Lord because he's faithful, and he will never suffer for the righteous to be moved. He'll never allow the righteous to be moved because we're planted in him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you. He's an incredible God. Yes, he is. Amen. Turn to somebody else and tell them something else that God has done for you. The Lord has given us eternal life through his sacrifice on the cross, and we're just thankful. Praise be to the Lord. Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. All right, on the count of three, just shout risen. One, two, three. Jesus, you're welcome in this building, God, but more than that, you're welcome in my heart. You're welcome in my heart, Jesus. Just come in, Lord, and do your work inside of me, God. Whatever it is that you want to do in me, Lord, I give you permission, God, because, Lord, you are a gentleman, and you will not force yourself in my heart, but, Lord, when my heart is open to you freely, God, then you will come in and do a transformation, Lord. So I welcome you in my heart, Jesus. Lord, I want you to rise again in my heart. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, just lift up a shout of praise unto the Lord. Lift up your own praise to the Lord. You are good. You are good, God. Your mercy is forever. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
saved you. We celebrate a risen Savior. Hallelujah. Come on, give him praise. Come on, give him praise. Hallelujah. He picked you up and turned you around. Come on, it's a good morning. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Come on, put those hands together. Oh, clap your hands.
We're Yeah.
Power is greater.
Yeah. Hi, my name's Carlos, and I just want to let everybody know that God is good. That when I first got to AJC, you know, I felt something different here at this church. My life was a total mess. You could say I was lost. But when I came here, I didn't leave the same. And then like 2 weeks later, I kept coming, and I decided to get baptized because I felt something different. And ever since I gave my life to the Lord, I want to tell you guys, it's been the best decision I've ever made. I want to encourage anyone to do that, because God can do the miraculous. Things that you never thought were possible, they are through Him. Jesus saved me completely. My life's different, healthier, better. And I just encourage everybody to make this decision. You know, I've decided.
Hi, my name is Samantha Martinez, and I joined AJC about 5 years ago. The Gomez family brought me in, and they brought me to church, and it was all kind of new to me. I didn't know what the atmosphere was going to be like, so when we went to altar call, I cried my heart out to God, and that's when He finally came into my life, and I just couldn't stop serving Him. One of the sisters came and prayed for me, and at that moment, I knew that God was real. I knew that He was gonna come down and save me from my distress, and He was gonna solve all my problems. I put Him first, and at that moment, I decided that I wanted to get baptized. It was the best decision that I ever made. I want to encourage all of you that no matter what you're going through, God is always gonna be there for you. Even if you're the first one in your family like I am, don't worry, your family will be baptized as well. I have faith, and I know that God will help you as He has helped me. And to let you know that I'm so glad that I decided to get baptized.
Hi, well, I'm Stacy William Kramer, and I just wanted to thank the Lord today for where He has brought me from where I was, at where I didn't want to be at from before. And that was doing the things that I knew that I'm not to do, but I did them anyways, which was drinking and doing legal meth, and I just been here for a year and a half here at AJC, and I'm just really happy to be here. I don't know how to say much, but I'm overwhelmed to be here because I was on drugs so bad that I never thought I would ever get off of them. And it's been over like 30 years since I've never been even normal in my life. And this is really my first time since I've been got baptized. And I have quit smoking and drinking and doing drugs for a year and a half now. And really happy to be here, and I encourage everybody else not to be going that way, not to even get started, because it's not the way to do, and that devil will take you down, and he won't let you go either. It's not easy. So I just take it from here to encourage you to stay at KJC right here and be an apostolic jubilee. Want to be here, and I just thank the Lord for here, for me being here. And I hope everything else is going well for everyone else, and like it is for me. And that's why I've been decided.
Hi, my name is Ingrid. Last year was probably one of the hardest times of my life. I lost my grandma to cancer, and I found myself being a single mom of three. And through all that, I felt so alone and lost. I stopped coming to church because, you know, I just felt like, you know, what was going on, everything turned into a big mess, like from one day to another. And I just thank God that throughout the whole time that I was going through that, He was there with me. All I just needed to do was just cry out to God and ask Him for help. And once I did, I seen that, you know, if it wasn't for Him, I wouldn't have made it through all that. He gave me the courage and the strength, even when I didn't see it. I'm so glad I just decided to come back to church, you know. It's the best thing I could have done. And if it wasn't for him loving me when I didn't want to be loved, I don't know where I've been, where I would have been. I've decided, you know, just to stay in church. It's the best thing to do. I've decided.
Grateful today. If you got something to be grateful for today, can you give the good Lord a round of applause? Thank you, Jesus. Now, real quick, as Mary Magdalene, as she went to the tomb and seen that the tomb was empty, her world was crushed. Where had they taken her Savior? And as she passes the gardener, he asks, Mary, you know, who are you looking for? Not knowing that the gardener was Jesus. And her back was towards the gardener who was Jesus. And it's kind of like our lives sometimes where we're just passing him by and our back's towards him. And there's one thing that just changed eternity. There's one thing that Jesus said. He called her by her name. In the book of John on chapter 10, Jesus said, I am like the shepherd and y'all like my sheep. And I love my sheep. Amen. And my sheep will know my voice, and I will call my sheep by their name. And just like that, Jesus said, Mary. And at that second, that nanosecond, that fraction of a second, her life changed. For when she turned around, there the Messiah was. Amen. In the flesh, resurrected. And I tell you today, just like Mary, he's calling you out. He's calling your voice. And we thank God today because we have multiple baptisms. Amen. Answered the calling. But I'm here to tell you today that if he could call Mary Magdalene, he could surely call you. Amen. So visitors, friend of mine, I want to let you know if you want to be baptized or if you want information on baptism or a Bible study, I encourage you to go out. Visit our visiting center, and we can give you the information for that. So if the ushers would please make their way to the front, it's time to pick up our offering. God bless you.
Come on, anybody excited that Jesus reigns in the house? Anybody excited that Jesus reigns? I'm going to try that again. Anybody excited that Jesus reigns over everything? Why don't you go ahead and put your hands together with us. Come on, say all hail.
All hail the King of Abraham. All hail the great I am.
The only King.
The only King who died. The only King who
celebrating the name of Jesus in this place today. Come on. Here's my favorite part right here. No one can be.
No one can be.
No one can kill.
No one can kill.
No one can dethrone.
No one can dethrone.
Cause he reigns.
He reigns. He reigns.
No one can be.
No one can be.
No one can kill.
No one can kill.
No one can dethrone.
No one can dethrone him.
Said he
reigns. He reigns.
No one can be.
No one can be.
No one can kill.
No one can kill.
No one can dethrone him.
No one can dethrone him.
Destroy this temple in 3 days. came Mary. For fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. Among the dead. He is not here.
He is not here.
For he has risen as he said.
For he has risen as he said.
See the place where the Lord used to lay.
See the place where the Lord lay.
Let's review the story one more time. The Lord spoke to the women and said, fear not. You're looking for the living among the dead. He is not here.
He is not here.
For he has risen as he said.
For he has risen as he said.
Come see the place where the Lord used to lay.
See the place where the Lord lay.
Remember how he said while he was yet in Galilee.
Remember how he said while he was yet in Galilee.
What did he say, sopranos? What did he say, surprise?
Oh, no!
and turn to your neighbor and say, he is not here. He's not at the tomb. And somebody say, where is he? I say, he's living in me. I have the living Christ. Help me have the living Christ inside of you. The hope of glory. That's why we shout about it. That's why we get excited about it. Because we don't serve a Savior that is dead. We serve a Savior that is alive. And he's alive and well. Amen. We're so honored to have everybody here today. Can we give all of our visiting friends a big round of applause? Amen. Everybody that's in the house. John chapter 11, verse 25. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. Amen. Jesus is the resurrection and the life. There is a better way today, and I want to just talk for a few moments on the subject, your forever starts today. Amen. Your forever starts today. There was a group of people hiking in the forest, and they were going one direction, and as they were heading towards the direction, in that certain direction, the first ranger came to them and said, the path that you're going is leading to a cliff. But where I'm going, there's a river. There's a place to camp out. There's food. And at that moment, this group had a decision to make. Do we believe what the forest ranger was telling them, or do they stay on their path that might have the potential of leading them to a cliff? John chapter 14, verse 6 says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father except through me. There's only one way, and his name is Jesus. Buddha said at the end of his life that I'm still searching for the truth. The Hindu scriptures say that truth is elusive and can point towards the truth. But Jesus says, I am the truth. I am the way. And I know there's at least 10 people that are confident that Jesus is the way, that his way leads to eternal life. I know you're clubbing, I know you're doing your thing, but I want to let you know, does that take you to eternal life? Because I got something that is better for you. His name is Jesus, and he is the way, he is the truth, and he is resurrected here today. Amen. The resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ is the cornerstone of our faith. It is the empty tomb, where if it wasn't a reality, there would be no Christian faith. But I thank God for an empty tomb. I thank God for Jesus Christ, who died on the cross, was buried, but on the third day rose, and he is alive. I know some of you came here today just to clear your conscience. You thought we were going to have a candlelight vigil about a Christ that is still on the cross. But I want to let you know, we got something greater, and that is an empty tomb. That means Jesus is alive, and he's looking to give eternal life to anybody who would believe. There's joy in the house here today. Mary Magdalene, when the angel told her, who you've been looking for is not here, she didn't just go back to her house. She went running. She went to go find the disciples. He's alive. He did it. He did it. Remember, he said, destroy this temple, but in three, he did it. Our God is awesome. The Savior that we believe can prophesy to himself and say, yep, you can destroy this temple, but in 3 days, I'll raise it up. That's the God I want to follow. That's the God I want to serve. He's big, and he's in this house. Amen. So the disciples, what? Jesus is he's alive. It's an empty tomb. Jesus shows himself, reveals himself. He says, I want you to go to an upper room. I want you to go to a room and I want you to stay there because I got to go. I'm leaving to heaven, but I'm going to give you my spirit that's going to guide you. And it's going to be your comforter. Amen. Aren't you glad for his spirit? Amen. And so Acts chapter 1 verse 12 says that when they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, verse 13, and they were come in and they went up into the upper room, both Peter and James and John, Andrew, Philip, Thomas, Bartholomew, Matthew, James. And verse 14, and they continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the woman and Mary, the mother of Jesus was there. Amen. And with his brethren. And in Acts chapter 2, it says these same people that as they were praying, 120, it says, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the house where they were sitting, and there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as a fire, and it sat upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. You think we're crazy? It started after the resurrection of Jesus Christ. You know, somebody here, the Shatarabakai, Mary, the mother of Jesus, was Shatayarabakai. They were filled with the Holy Ghost because of the power, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. He were walking. What's that noise? What's going on up there? Somebody said, they're drunk. They're crazy. They've lost their mind. And so they started gathering all the chismosos, all the gossipers. I don't know what's going on, but Mary, the mother of Jesus, she done lost her mind. Poor mother lost her son. But she was being endued by power from the Most High. I want to let you know, I know the world is in crisis, but you're in the house of refuge here today. Jesus is in this house. We're not depressed. We might have lost some people along the way. We might have lost a house. But guess what? We're not crazy. We got Jesus. We found Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Amen. So they said, they're crazy. And the first resurrection service, because Jesus had resurrected, was in Acts chapter 2 when Peter comes out of the house filled with the Holy Ghost. And in Acts chapter 2 verse 22 and 24 says, men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs which God did through him in your midst, as you yourselves also know him. Being delivered by the determined purpose and foreknowledge of God, you have taken by lawlessness hands, have crucified and put to death whom God has raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it was not possible that he should be held. But I serve a God that cannot be held in a tomb. He cannot be held by death. He's big enough. And so Peter says that same Savior that you crucified, he is now risen. This is where the American church does not respond like the original church in the book of Acts. You see, because thousands upon thousands will go to an Easter Sunday service and they will do a vigil. They'll light a candle. They'll pay their respects. Like Jesus needs you to pay your respect. He's not dead. Some of you like, I need to go pay my respect. Poor little Jesus. Like we owe him something. Amen. He gave his life for us. We owe him our life. That's all we owe him, a simple hallelujah. When I think of the goodness of Jesus, let the clubbers club, let the rowdy be rowdy, but let the church be loud here today, because I serve a risen Christ that healed me, delivered me from drugs, saved a marriage. You can be cute. And we hear that Jesus died and that he rose again. And thank you, Jesus. And then we even do those little prayers. Poor baby Jesus. And then we go home unchanged. We don't see you till next Easter. Nobody knows that we are a Christian. I believe that there are people here today that Jesus is not your ultimate Savior. What he is a spare tire. Some of us, we have Jesus in the trunk. So just in case the doctors tell me I have an incurable disease, when I lose my job, when my husband finally walks out on me, I know where Jesus is. I want to tell you something. Jesus is not just in case of emergency. He is the Savior of my life. He is the joy of my substance. He is the peace that passeth all understanding. He is a Savior that saved me from a burning hell. Every day I walk with him. Every day I talk to him. Every day I get excited about just knowing that he's on my side. The early church didn't just hear the gospel message and say, that's great, that's cute, God bless you. They asked Peter a question, and they said, what must we do? When they heard about this Savior that died for them, was buried, but on the third day rose again, they didn't say, how embarrassing if I follow Jesus. So what should I do first? Like be baptized or repent or get the Holy? Which one do I have to do them in order? What if my hair gets curly in the water? I'm going to lose all my friends. Let me tell you something. Some of you have friends because you buy them the drinks. Some of your friends are because you're just as depressed and discouraged as them. But the moment you start rolling it up, smoking it up, and drinking it up, guess what? They're going to stop calling. Amen. It's none of my business, though. None of my business. They did not ask the questions. They did not make excuses. They said, what must we do? They didn't say the ham is waiting. They said, what must we do? And Peter said, I'm glad you asked. Acts chapter 2, verse 38. Repent. That means that path that you're going is leading to a cliff. Jesus has the better way. Turn yourself around and follow him. Follow him to eternal life. Amen. Come on, the path of depression and discouragement and your third divorce, fifth divorce, blaming everybody because your dad walked on you. Come on, turn it around and follow peace and joy and eternal life and joy everlasting. He said, repent and then be baptized. Get to the water in the name of Jesus for the remission of your sins. Amen. Water is important because it is symbolic to the decision that we made in the power of the blood of Jesus to wash us. Amen. And you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. What the Holy Church, what the first church, the early church got. Amen. No, we don't even go to the first thing, repent. We're like, this is taking too long. Yeah, hurry up. Let me tell you something. America And the reason I'm preaching like this is because half of you won't come back tomorrow, next Sunday. So I got to preach because I'm the pastor here. Amen. I got to get you filled up. We got a bunch of wusses in America. Excuse my language. We had a little bit over 147 Christians die in Kenya for the name of Jesus. Yet you cannot stop rolling it up, smoking it up, drinking it up, clubbing it up because it's too much. My God, do you love Jesus? Do you believe in the power of Jesus? It's the only thing that can change your life. Stop making your excuses. Stop saying Sunday is my day off. Sunday is my day to get to church and thank God. Amen. Like I said, quote me the Quran. I don't know the Quran, but I know for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. That whosoever believeth in me, him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. You quote me a Quran. I don't know the Quran, but I know that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And if you kill me, you can't destroy me, because I got something eternal inside of me. His name is Jesus. Let's be louder. Let's be louder than fear. Let's be louder than terror. We got Jesus. I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. You go to church on Sunday? Yes, I do. And you should come with me too. You don't do that. I remember Brother Angel. I always say his testimony because he was just a mean fella. But I heard of him. I don't know him too much. You know, prior to his conversion, they say, you know, you're just looking. Well, it's kind of hard. I mean, his muscles, he must have been mean. You know, he had big muscle. But he said when he gave his life to the Lord, was baptized, his job, his friend, they said, Angel, why are you smiling so much? You need to stop smiling. Let me tell you something. This joy that he received, not a tax write-off, not a raise, not a friend could give him that joy. It was the joy of the Lord. It was something that he found because the Jesus that died for him was buried on the third day rose. Amen. He's the way. I wonder if somebody here today, if terror would ever come into our communities, if you would denounce Jesus. I bet you wouldn't. Based off your Facebook, based off your excuse of why you can't give your life to the Lord. Yeah, we got people in Muslim countries being beheaded and dying unashamed. Let me tell you something. I love this environment. I love how the church threw the best party for a resurrected Savior here today. We're going to get loud up in this house. And tomorrow we're going to get louder and louder because Jesus is coming for a church. Come on, son. I don't know if you know, Friday morning or Saturday morning, I woke up and there was a blood moon. I said, I get it, Jesus. You're coming. I get it. I get it. They said, What must we do? The New Testament believer believed the gospel and they got baptized. It's the Bible. The book of Acts. You're gonna watch it on NBC. I don't know how accurate they're gonna be, but read it for yourself. The book of Acts. Everyone that believed, they were baptized. They found some water, and they were baptized. Let me tell you, what is baptized? I use a good excuse. I use a good example. Baptism is like a Krispy Kreme donut. It isn't a Krispy Kreme donut until it is baptized and glazed.
And when that thing's baptized in glaze, it is good. Let me tell you something. You cannot be sprinkled. You must get all the way in. Not just your ankles, not just your knees. Honey, you got to get all the way in. And you must be buried with Jesus. And you're going to come out a resurrected individual. Amen. Praise God. Find me scriptures. The early church, they did not just believe and that's it. They were baptized. A Christian is not a follower if you're not really following him. If you haven't believed and if you weren't baptized and if you're not living a spirit-filled life, you're not a believer. Amen. I'm sorry. As much as I love my girlfriend, I can't call her my wife if I don't marry her. Amen. We could play husband and wife all we want, but until I commit, we need to start playing church and be a believer. And how do we be a believer like the early church? What? Jesus died? Yes. He was buried? Yes. He rose again. What must we do? Repent, be baptized in the name of Jesus for the remission of your sins, and be filled with the Holy Ghost. Let's do it. Let's do it. What? One. Let's do it. Two. Let's do it. Three, four, five, six. 100, 300, 400, 800. The first resurrection service, 3,000 were baptized in the name of Jesus. Amen. Follow Jesus, for it leads to eternity. Amen. To follow Christ is to repent from this life and turn around and follow a better life, which is Jesus. Jesus is the better life. Amen. John chapter 3 verse 36 says, whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. But whoever rejects the Son will not see life, for God's wrath remains on them. Today you got two options. Number one, believe on Jesus Christ. Act on this gospel, and your sins, your transgressions, that will be placed on the cross, and it will be done in the water. You'd be clean slate in the water. Or don't believe, don't act on it, and you carry the weight of sin for the rest of your life. Jesus is the only way that leads to salvation. Romans chapter 6 verse 4 says, we were therefore buried with him, how? Through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead, the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. Amen. Not just by confession, but being buried with him through water baptism. Amen. When you are baptized, it is going, you are going into Jesus, and it's being buried. We got some candidates here today. What we're going to do is you're going to see new life. You want to see a miracle? You're going to see it today. Somebody that came into these waters with sin, with an eternal condemnation, and because of the resurrected Christ, they will be washed anew. Let me tell you something about the first resurrection service, and then I will be done. Acts chapter 2, verse 41. Listen to the response. They didn't just come and pay their homage, pay their respect. They didn't just come and, you know, dear baby Jesus. They didn't just come and say, oh, I just feel so sorry for the man. Remember, he died because he felt sorry for us. And Acts chapter 2, verse 41 says, then those who gladly received his word that he died and that he was buried and that he rose again on the third day, for those that gladly heard and received his word, they were baptized. And that day, about 3,000 souls. Could you imagine? Can you imagine the day that America is actually glad to receive the word of the Lord? I'm going to tell you something right now. I want to prophetically tell you the time and the season that this world is in is like the days when Israel turned their back against God and they called good bad and bad good and they killed the prophets. We are living in a time that people will kill the church. They're going to go after the pastor. They're going to go after truth because they will love to call bad good and they will call good bad. And that's the hour we're living in right here, right now. Get ready. Jesus is coming. Jesus is coming. And just like the days of Noah, you were dropping it like it's hot. You were parting like it's 1999. But Noah was building an ark. Why? Because he knew it was going to rain. There is a church here today that believes in the rapture of the church. Call us crazy. Keep doing what you're doing. But we're getting our house in order. Because he's coming again. Today, people have heard the gospel and they have believed it, and they're going to be baptized in the name of Jesus. Amen. Listen, as I come to a close this resurrection service, because it has to convict our hearts to change and become better people. The death of Jesus Christ and his resurrection must convict our heart to become more radical for Jesus. To live more louder for Jesus. To not be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. For it is life. It is salvation. You need to be loud for Jesus. But I got an offer here today. I got an offer here today. And that offer is the following. If your friends, if your finances, if your job can guarantee you eternal life when your life is over on this in this life, you don't need to hear this sermon. If you know that your money can get you into peace and into life when your life finishes here today, yeah, disregard this message. If your boyfriend can save you from a burning hell, you don't need the cross and you don't need an empty tomb. If your girlfriend can rescue you from the gates of hell for all of eternity, disregard this message. But if there is 1% in your heart that says, I know, and nothing can guarantee salvation from an eternal hell, then you need Jesus. And he died for you. He was buried. But my friend, I got good news. He rose again. He rose again so that you can have the power of the resurrection, that when you die in this life, from the balcony all the way to the front row, I want to let you know. Do you know that this life that you are in right here, right now, is only preparing you for eternal life? Do you know that your life actually begins when this life is over? Because this life, even if you live to be 90 years, what is 90 years in comparison to all eternity? What is it in comparison? 80 years compared to all of eternity. But since we are here on this earth, Jesus came down and he loved us with the cross, even as painful as it was. And he was buried, but on the third day, he rose again, and he has brought life to this world so that when this life expires, how many have a milk carton at home? Raise your hand if you got. If not, I'll give you $5 and you can go. Listen, Tomorrow when you have your cereal, I want you to be reminded of Pastor Gary, because that's the gospel message. The milk has an expiration date. And that carton is just holding the milk that is good just for a moment. This life has an expiration date. It's going to end. And when it ends, what you're doing and how you're living, is it a guarantee that it's going to save you from all of eternity without the presence of God? You see, right here, right now, God, in His great mercy, is reaching out to you while you have life. Because when your life is over, there is a divine responsibility of what you have heard and how you have lived your life for Him. In the early church, they didn't just come and that was a cute service. They said, what must we do? They were already taking down their braid. They were taking on, what must we do? Repent. Turn your life around from the path that you're... Be water baptized in the name that is above every other name. And a name because of the cross, because He endured the cross, He was given a name above every other name, which men can be saved. We heal in that name. We deliver in that name. We receive salvation in this beautiful name, and it is Jesus Christ. Some said, well, I was baptized in John. No, but it's not the name. It's not the name of Jesus. Be baptized again. And they were baptized. Hundreds and hundreds of people that were baptized in the name of John the Baptist, they were baptized in this precious name of Jesus. Because it's the only one that died for us. It's the only one that ever rose again. And it's the only one that has an empty tomb. And this Savior here today has to convict us more than just wearing pastel colors on an Easter Sunday morning. But it must convict us to live a better life. And a life louder than this life. Do you believe that His way is the better way? That His life has eternal life, and today is your day. And I want everyone, if you could just bow your head. And as we get ready to celebrate new life here today, two things. Number one, for those that have believed but you haven't been baptized, that's your next step. You have to be baptized. You got to put actions into what you believed. If you're not a believer today, first thing first, repent. Ask God to come into your life and turn from your direction that you are going to, that's leading to a cliff. Second, be baptized. And the Spirit of God will lead you, guide you, fill you. I also want to talk to those that have been baptized and you just show up to holiday services. The Bible says in Acts chapter 2, verse 42, and they continue steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and in the breaking of bread and in prayers. The next big thing we do is we stay connected to a local church. And if you haven't been connected to a local church, welcome home. Welcome to AJC. Amen. Be loud with all of us. Get involved with all of us. You have to not just repent and be baptized and be Spirit-led, but you have to do what the early church did. They were connected. They're a part of a church. This is God's family. I want everybody real quick, we're going to hold our breath for 2 seconds. You ready?
I'm not a personal trainer, so my sit-ups, like seconds, is like one, two, I'm done, you know. I just feel good, you know, my fast second. So I'm going to do my seconds, all right? So everybody ready? Hold your breath. Okay, let go. You can breathe. Anybody die? No. Say something. 2 seconds in water. When you rise up, eternal life. Eternal life. But I'm going to get wet and my hair's going to fall and, oh, people are going to see me. Remember the cross. When Jesus hung naked, took the stripes, took the beating, was disfigured. They said you couldn't even recognize him based off the beating. He did it unashamedly because he loved you. We now say, if he's willing to give his life for me, I am going to make a bold statement. And I'm going to let the whole world know that I am now a follower of Jesus Christ. And I'm going to be baptized. For all AJC members, I want to let you know, let's just be louder than ever before. In our worship, in our convictions, with our love for God. And let's continue to pray for our church all throughout the world that is being persecuted. And I want you to look at their persecution based off what holds you back from serving God. And say, is it really worth it? Every hand raised. Every hand raised. Today, somebody's forever is going to begin. The whole purpose of the death, burial, and resurrection will be experienced to the life of somebody here today. I believe, Jesus, that you died for me. That you gave your life. It could not be bought with money. It had to be purchased with the price. And yet you believed me. You believed in me. You loved me. You knew I was going to be stubborn. You knew I was going to be strong-willed. You knew I was going to fail. Yet you purchased my life in advance. And Father, like the early church in the first resurrection sermon, they say, what must we do? Repent, be baptized. Okay, got it. Let's do it. Where's the water? Stop the car. Stop the carriage. Lead me to water. Get me to a place where I can be baptized. Listen, you don't have to be perfect. God, you know I'm not perfect. You know I got issues. But then that's why you died for me, right? That's why Jesus died for me, became a sacrifice. Because I'm not perfect. So you got to realize and recognize that nobody will ever be perfect and be okay with that. That we're all a work in progress. Don't you even say, I'm a work in progress. Amen. I guarantee you some people, if they weren't spirit-filled, the vodka would come out in them in the parking lot. Come on, somebody. Amen. But we're all a work in progress. This moment, it's not a time of just remembering the death of Jesus Christ. It's now asking the question, what must I do? How can I live boldly for Jesus Christ? Because eternity is right around the corner. I want every hand raised. So all he wants is just us recognize, I need a Savior. I need help. I can't do this on my own. Once again, if you think you can save yourself from eternity, I'm not God and I'm not going to put you into eternity when your funeral comes. I'll preach to you right here, right now. Turn from your way and serve the Lord. Repent, be baptized, be spirit-filled, be spirit-led. This is the gospel. This is the response of the gospel that Jesus died, he was buried, and he rose again. Listen, Nike has this sign that says, just do it, right? Okay. How many of us know that when we go swimming, The worst thing we do is go toe by toe and foot by foot. You know why? Because we're like, and so two things are going to either happen. Your big brother is going to come and throw you in. Or you just need to run and just jump. And in the middle of the air, like, oh my God, what if I just. If you're thinking about it, we're always going to find an excuse. I'm not ready. I'm not. Really, you're not ready? Remember, Christians in Muslim countries being beheaded, killed. What are you not ready from? What are the things of this flesh that you love more than the cross of Jesus Christ? So just forget the toe by toe. Just by faith, jump into it and make the best decision of your life. What must we do? And on the first resurrection service, 3,000 were baptized. Can you imagine? 3,000. Why? Because they fully and gladly received the message. Father, I pray for everyone that is here today as we get ready to celebrate new life. Father, I preached your mandate. I try not to be cute. I try not to water it down, but just what you wanted to tell us, because following you is about taking our cross and denying ourselves and following you. And so today, I pray that this service would not be a religious gathering. It would not be a time where we would just come and commemorate your death, but that we would celebrate your resurrection and that we would feel accountable and responsible and being unashamed of your gospel. And I pray here today that people from all different walks of life can come to the knowledge of Jesus Christ. My friend, don't wait, just do it. Just jump in. Listen, if you prefer Aquanet, I'll go to the store and get you Aquanet for after your baptism. We got towels, we got shorts, we got shirts you could take home. We got, you know, little banana clips. I mean, whatever you need that would make you have an excuse not to give your life to the Lord, I want to let you know we got it covered. If you have not been baptized here today, all you got to do is just walk into the foyer and just say, show me the way. Show me the way. And they'll take you to the baptistry room. Just, I want to get baptized. And today, you don't need to come to the altar. All you just got to do is just get to the foyer and somebody will point you to where you need to go. And in the name of Jesus right now, every hand raised. And I pray here today that somebody, there's already people. Amen. Praise God. Hey, what? All right. Awesome. Is that okay? This is the daughter of the guy that smiles a lot. Brother Angel, all three of your children will now be baptized. Listen, it's just that easy. I'll do it. I'll do it. Get me into the water. Your forever starts right here, right now. Nowhere in the New Testament, in the church, was just a confession. You have to act on it. You have to act on it. It's not just confession. You got to act on it. And here today, your forever starts right here, right now. Guess what? My second son has accepted Jesus Christ. He's going to be baptized this afternoon. It's a great day. This is the power of the cross. And I want everyone just to please stand, and I want you to raise your hand. Every hand raised. This new life, this new beginning begins now.
has the power to cleanse you. It has the power to wash you and make you new again with eternal life.
For it reaches to the highest mountain.
That's the power of Jesus. And it flows.
And it flows to the lowest valley.
The blood.
Oh, the blood that gives me strength.
Thank you for the cross.
Of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost.
Lord, treat
Like this family for now in
the name of Jesus.
Because, you know, the Valdezes, they know how to praise God. Amen. We're going to give the Lord a shout, amen, because our house will be saved. As for me and my house, we shall serve the Lord. Celeste Valdez, I'm going to baptize you in the name of Jesus, that your name would be written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and no man will ever be able to be erased it in Jesus' name.
Say, my house.
She doesn't wake up early on Sundays. She woke up early, and I knew it was an act of God. She said, Daddy, I got to give my life to the Lord. She goes, I'm going to get baptized. I go, do you know what you're doing? She goes, yeah, I know what I'm doing. She goes, I'm going to get baptized today along with my brother. This is my church family. Will you celebrate with me as I baptize my youngest, Layla Anise Gray? We baptize you in the name of Jesus, that your name would be written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and that no man will ever be able to erase your name, and that you would serve the Lord for the rest of your life, in Jesus' name. I baptize you in the name of Jesus for the remission of your sins. You have received the gift of the Holy Ghost, that Adam Isaiah Gray's name would be written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And when we baptize you in Jesus' name, the church is going to shout. The church is going to praise. We're going to love God in Jesus' name. Thank you.
just imagine one day 3,000 being baptized. Mary, the mother of Jesus, she's somewhere just like you think people are crazy here. All the saints of other religions, Paul, Peter, Matthew, Bartholomew, speaking it up. Man, the rapture is coming and we're going to leave crazier for Jesus. I want us at the count of three to shout because we serve a risen Jesus, a risen Savior. You ready? One, two, three, shout! He's alive! He's alive! It's in me! I feel him in my hands! I feel him in my feet! I don't need drugs! I don't need alcohol! Jesus! About it. Let's leave here dancing about it. Listen, we'll be here next Sunday at 1 p.m. and we'll have more baptism because the Bible says, and the church added, the Lord added. They were hearing about this risen Savior and the